Welcome to Electron Line. In this video, we're going to explore the RL circuit, the circuit that has both a resistor and an inductor in it. That's what R and L stands for. And of course, you also have a battery and we have a switch. And so what we're doing here is at time equals zero, we're closing the switch. And at that point, the battery will try to drive a current through the circuit here in a clockwise direction. Of course, we know that the resistor will oppose a current, but an inductor will oppose the change in the current. So initially when the battery tries to push a current through the circuit, the inductor will first slow it down, and then slowly the battery will drive the current through the circuit and will reach a maximum value towards the end. If we were to graph that, it would look something like this. So if we have the current as a function of time, and then we have time here on the denominator, what it would look like is initially when you close the switch, it would be no current at all. Then the current would begin to increase and then eventually hit a final value after a certain amount of time has passed. And so asymptotically, the current would reach closer and closer and closer to what we would deem to be the final value. I'm trying to get this about right. There we go. And typically speaking, the amount of time that it takes to reach a final value is known as a period of what we call five time constants. And we use the letter tau to indicate the time constant. We'll get into a moment what that really is. All right? The time constant depends upon the value of the resistor and the inductor. So let's talk about the time constant. So the time constant on a circuit depends on the size of both the inductor and the resistor, and we use the letter tau to indicate that, and the ratio is equal to L divided by R. And that makes a lot of sense, because the bigger L is, the bigger the inductor is, the more it will oppose the change in the current, and the longer it will take for the current to reach its final value. So therefore, tau would be bigger, it would be a bigger time constant. R would make it smaller if R is bigger. For example, a bigger resistor would cause a smaller overall current to exist at the end when you reach steady state, and so it would be more quickly to reach that final value because it's a smaller final value. So a bigger resistor would make a smaller time constant. Now, what we want to do here is try to analyze how the current will operate or how the current will flow through the circuit as time is allowed to pass. And to do that, we use what we call Kirchhoff's rule in going around the circuit and determining the voltage drop across each of the three components. Now, we know that we go from left to right across the battery, the voltage will increase by the amount of the battery, by the EMF provided by the battery. So that means a positive voltage increase. When we travel in the direction of the current and we cross a resistor, that will cause a voltage drop. The voltage drop across the resistor is the current times the resistance. And finally, when we travel across the inductor in the direction of the assumed current, then we know that the voltage drop across the inductor is equal to the inductance, L, times the change of the current with respect to time. Now, if the current were to be decreasing, if we have a negative DIdt, then the negative will cancel out the negative, and this would be a positive quantity. We actually would have a voltage rise. But the equation takes care of that for us in itself. It simply says L times DIdt with the negative sign in front of it. That's the voltage change across the inductor. It'll be a voltage drop when the current is increasing. It'll be voltage rise in this direction when the current is decreasing. And of course, if we add up all the voltage drops around the circuit, they should add up to zero. Now what we're trying to determine is what will be the current at time is equal to zero and what will be the current when time approaches infinity. Not really infinity, but a long enough period so we get to the steady state value of the current. Well, think about it. In order to figure that out, we're going to solve this equation right here. We're going to solve that equation for di dt. So we're going to move this over to the other side, and then we're going to turn the equation over so we end up with L times di dt. So that means when we move this to the right side, it becomes positive. Then we switch the equation around, and this is now on the other side. So this would be is equal to the voltage across the battery minus I times R. Now we're going to divide both sides by L. So we end up with di dt is equal to 1 over L times the voltage across the battery minus I times R. And finally, we're going to factor out a negative R. The reason why we do that is we want the I to be positive here. We're going to switch that around. And we want the R to be outside that. So we end up with di dt is equal to minus R over L time, so this becomes positive I, and this becomes negative, and then of course we still have to divide that by R, so E divided by R, because at that point we know that if we multiply this back in, the R's cancel out, we end up back with what we ended up with. So that's a very special way of writing it, because we want an end result that will utilize that particular way of writing it. Now, what we want to do here is try to figure out, at time equals zero, what will be the current? Well, we know that since the switch closes and the battery tries to drive charge or current through the circuit, the inductor will initially oppose it, and at the very beginning, there'll be absolutely no current through the circuit. So what we can say is, at t equals zero, I has to equal zero. However, what we know is, if I is equal to zero, then we know that the change in the current time at that time would be this times that. Notice the R's would cancel out, the negatives would cancel out, and the change of the current respect to time would simply be the voltage divided by the inductor. So we can say that at t equals zero, the didt would be equal to the voltage from the battery divided by the inductor. So we know that at the very beginning, when the switch closes, the slope of this line, which represents the change in the current with respect to time, is equal to the voltage of the battery divided by the size of the inductor. That also makes sense when you think about it. The greater the voltage across the battery, the greater the current change is going to be, the harder the current is going to be driven by the battery, and the greater the inductor, the more the inductor will oppose the current. A bigger denominator means a smaller change in the current, so the slope will be not as steep. All right, what will happen when time goes to infinity, when a lot of time has gone by? Well, at that point, we expect that the current will have reached its final value. So what we can say here is that the current will now be equal to the final value of the current, and we also know at that point that the change in the current will go to zero. Notice that the slope eventually becomes zero, so the change in the current goes to zero. So we can say that the idt is going to be equal to zero. If we plug those values in here, then what do we get? So this becomes zero, so zero is equal to minus R over L times the current will have reached its final value, which is I sub F, and then there would be minus E over R. All right, so that means if the left side, which is zero, is equal to the right side, that means since this is a constant which cannot be equal to zero, we can go ahead and get rid of that because we can multiply both sides by negative L over R. So we can say that zero is equal to I final minus E over R. And so if we solve that for the right side, so if the right side equals zero, that means, conclusion is, that the final current has to equal E over R. And that makes sense as well, because notice, that's final here, notice that if we allow the switch to close and we allow the current to get to its final value, when it gets to its final value, the change of the current becomes zero, and at that point the inductor will no longer oppose the change in current because there's none, and so then it simply becomes a resistor circuit. And then of course the current will simply be the voltage divided by the resistance according to Ohm's law. So far so good. Now we want to find an equation that describes the current, not at the very beginning, because we know that the current will be zero at the very beginning, and not the end, because at the end we'll have reached the steady state value equal to this, but now we want an equation that describes what happens in between. We want an equation that describes that curve right there. So to determine the equation for this curve right here between t equals zero and t equals infinity, or near infinity where we reach steady state, I'm going to take this equation and solve this equation for I. So to do that, I have to separate the variables and integrate both sides of the equation. So let's do that. We'll take this equation right here and write it as di divided by this portion right here, which is I minus E over R is equal to, I leave this on the right side, minus R over L times dt. So now I've separated the variables. My I is on the left side and my t is on the right side. I now integrate both sides. The left side integrate from I equals zero to I equals I, whatever I have somewhere between this period right here, and the time is going to go from zero to t. So I go ahead and integrate. On the left side, this looks like that's the natural log. So we have the natural log of I minus E over R evaluated from 0 to I, and that equals minus R over L times T evaluated from 0 to T. So at any point in time T, and whatever the current will be at that particular point in time I. So when I plug in the values, so here I get the natural log of I minus E over R minus the natural log of minus E over R is equal to minus R over L times T, because when I plug in the lower limit I get 0, so I don't have to worry about that. Now I can simplify this. This means that I get the natural log of I minus E over R divided by minus E over R equals minus R over L times T. At that point, I can take the antilog of both sides to get rid of the natural log. So I'll move over here. I take the antilog, I get E to the natural log of I minus E over R divided by minus E over R. And that should equal E to the minus R over L times T. Let me draw a line here so we don't get this confused. All right. At that point, I continue, but notice that the time constant was defined as L over R, and here I have R over L. So I move the R over L to the denominator, which means I have to flip it over, take the inverse. I will then get the time constant in the denominator, and of course, this cancels out that, so I end up with I minus E over R divided by minus E over R is equal to E to the minus T over the inverse, which is L over R. And of course, L over R is equal to the time constant of that circuit. Then I bring this across over here, so if I simplify this, I get I is equal to, bring this across, I get I minus E over R is equal to minus E over R times E to the minus T over tau. And finally, I can bring the minus E over R to the other side, becomes positive, factor out an E over R, and so know that the current as a function of time, which is represents the time period here, the current at any point in time, is going to be equal to E over R times 1 minus E to the minus T over tau. Like so. Now, remember, E over R, what does that represent? Well, again, eventually, when the current comes to a steady state, and the current stops changing, the inductor stops opposing the change because there's no longer a change in current, and it simply becomes a resistor circuit, and that means that E over R is simply the final current in the circuit. So I can write this as, simplified, I can write this as I as a function of time is equal to the final current times 1 minus E to the minus T over tau. And that is the equation that describes the current of an RL circuit during the period where the current increases from 0 when you first close the switch to the final steady state value, which is I sub F. Notice this equation, E to the minus T over tau. If T becomes very large, E to minus large exponent really becomes 0, so it simply becomes 1 minus 0, which is simply the final current. And that's what the equation then describes. If, however, time is equal to 0, E to the 0 is 1, 1 minus 1 is 0, therefore the current at time equals 0 is 0, which the slope there or the equation there, the function indicates. All right, so here we have a nice way of determining, theoretically, what the current will be like in a circuit like this, in an RL circuit, when we first close a switch. We can see by using Kirchhoff's rules and adding up all the voltages across every device, and then solving that equation for the current, we get an equation that describes the current perfectly as a function of time. Keeping in mind that initially at t equals 0, the current is 0, and the change in the current, the slope of that equation is E over L, and at the final value, not necessarily at infinity, but as time passes, and enough time has passed that the current becomes the final current, the steady state value means that the current no longer changes, and that would be the final value of the current right there. Notice at that point, I will be equal to I final, which is equal to, as we discovered here, simply Ohm's law, E over R, and that is the final value of the current when we reach steady state. And that's how we do that.